Okay. Koiso Ibaub. And welcome all to our creative conversations. And a particular warm welcome, and I think it is warm actually, so to our new cohort of Creative Wales alumni this year. We know who you are. Well, we do. No, but you know who you are. And we'll all know who you are by the end of the evening. And we hope that you'll have met lots of people that maybe you do know and some people you don't know too. So it's an evening of celebration for them, but it's also an evening of serious intent. Creative Wales Award winners are joined by friends and family, but we've also got guests from the university and who have helped us in the study that we're going to spend the first part of the evening talking about. And I'm really pleased to welcome you to G39. We thought we might have to re-baptize G39 as sort of G3.9 in relation to the thermometer this morning. But it feels cozy. We want to keep it cozy through the afternoon and the evening. Thanks for all your journeys here. Thanks for all your creative journeys that have brought you here. Tonight is a way of bringing you together. It is a way of celebrating what you achieve individually and what you go on achieving. But in the room are some fascinating creative journeys, and I hope you get to share them with colleagues tonight, just what you're up to and what you plan to do. Last year, we were saying that the Creative Wales artists, we are really a collective network and a powerhouse for the arts in Wales. Well, we've been piloting a Yammer network for you over the year. And it's intended to provide a means for putting you all in touch and for us to stay in touch with you too and to create some informal but powerful network across the award winners since 2002. Of Creative Wales. There'll be more of that next week when we follow up from tonight's session and we get back in touch with you, and we'll be inviting you to join that network. Each Creative Wales evening presents us with something of a landmark moment, not just in individual careers, but for us as an Arts Council too. The Arts Council of Wales has placed our support for individual artists as a bedrock for the work we do. It's impossible to think, obviously, of the arts without artists. Sometimes some people think we maybe are thinking of other things, but at the heart of that thinking, whether it's the fantastic programme developing in schools now through the creative learning, through the arts, where our focus remains building the artistic capital of Wales. It was there in our Inspire strategy. The Inspire strategy has had some good reviews. Jude Kelly is on record as saying, as far as strategies go, we're best in show. Well, she didn't quite put it that way, but so in talking about maybe generalities of what we want to see come about in Wales, Inspire clearly put artists and our support to artists at the heart of the enterprise. And to do that, we said there were things we needed to do. We needed to not just get to know artists better, which is the day-to-day job, the day job, but we needed to take some steps back too and research the situation of artists in Wales. So we commissioned the largest piece of research on the individual state of the artist in Wales, ever. But it is building on other work. And we're really grateful to Fieldwork for picking up the brief, and for Fieldwork to link up with the university and the research department there, which could look at analysing statistical returns to inform that research. And we're grateful too to all those artists who participated back in autumn, or in slightly earlier, on just a survey, a piece of survey work that we did out to artists to try and benchmark where they felt they were from their income point of view, from their career point of view, from how they understand what it is to work in Wales. So that research has come back to us, and this week we've published it, and we'll be looking forward to how we build on it. Fieldwork came up with some really interesting insights into the situation of the artist in Wales, none of which will be surprising, perhaps, to you in this room. Nor were they necessarily surprising to us. But there are challenges there for the Arts Council if we're going to continue to place the artist at the heart of our work. So this evening, in part, is about launching that study, hearing a bit more about it, hoping that when we launch the network next week, we'll continue the dialogue about the situation of the artist in Wales, and that Council itself, as it returns to the subject in March and this spring, will do so with a real sense of the challenges, but also the opportunities for Wales to continue to support its precious artistic base. So the format of tonight gets you to do some work, as well as us to do some work, before we all can celebrate the successes of Creative Wales 2017. We hope that work will actually be quite informal for you and will be one of the ways in which you can talk to each other this evening. But the first part of our session is around just giving you a feel for what that research threw up. And I'm joined on the stage by Chris Ricketts from Fieldwork, who's going to do a short presentation about the research. Dimi Stoyanova-Russell from Wizard in Cardiff University. Dimi spent the time talking to artists do qualitative research on how they feel about matters. And Dimi's going to share some of that approach and some of the things that she found. I'm joined too by my colleague Caris Wynne Morgan, who has been leading on the internal group that has been looking at support to individual artists, and by our national advisor and a familiar figure to lots of you in the room, Ian Rowlands. Ian, playwright, director, a Creative Wales alumni in his own right. So Ian's going to contribute some of his thinking about Creative Wales, but also about the situation of the artist. There'll be time for you to talk, discuss around the tables, and then we're going to bring the afternoon to a close with what promises to be a lively debate, conversation, between and with Ned Thomas and Ed Thomas, the Ned and Ed show, as it's become known in the office. So without more ado, I'm going to ask Chris to come and share the research with you.
Thank Thank you, David. Nice to be here in a nice room of people. Congratulations, those who are getting their rewards tonight. Hope those who got their rewards last year have had a good year, or still having a good year. It's an important part of the support for individual artists, and that came through very strongly in the work that we did on this piece of research. Fieldwork is me, and Kerry Jones, who some of you know from when she worked at the Arts Council in Craft and Visual Arts, and we both worked together at Wales Arts International for a time. Wizard is part of Cardiff University and part of a collaborative venture that sits alongside five universities in Wales and seems to be particularly good at looking at data and looking at economic impact and social and economic research. Dimi is from within Cardiff Business School. When the tender came out for this particular piece of research, we put a feeler out into Cardiff University to see who might be there that might be interested in getting involved with us in terms of doing the research. And we're delighted that Dimi and Rhys, who works within Wizard, came back as part of the team. It's quite a big report. It goes quite dense in parts. It goes quite numeric in parts, but that's part of what the brief was about, was trying to get some hard data about what some of your lives are like, as much as your lives can be reduced to data. I got a bit nerdy about SOC codes and SIC codes, but I'm not going to talk about any of that because it really does get a bit nerdy. What we're just going to do now is talk through some of the headlines and just sort of give you a flavour of some of the things that were in it and a sense of some of the recommendations that we've made to the Arts Council. It is all up online. It is there to be read and enjoyed and digested slowly, like Stilton and port at Christmas, probably. But we hope it's a useful contribution to what this important field of work is about. So the pitch that we put into the Arts Council had three areas to it in terms of the research. One was qualitative, one was quantitative, and one was about desk research. The qualitative is what Dimi led on, and in a nutshell was all about asking questions and listening to people's responses and then drawing things out of that. And the quantitative was the work that Rhys did, and he is a real proper nerdy number cruncher. And the desk research was partly about trying to find ways and connections between the things that we were discovering and about doing some comparisons about how Wales stood alongside other parts of the United Kingdom. David's mentioned already the Creative Professional Survey, which is the extra bit of research that's come out and is up on the Arts Council's website. I'll just pull a few numbers out of that bit of surveying because I think it's got some quite useful things in it. One of the things that I think came through really strongly to us through our discussions with artists and creative professionals was this, which I think is what the Arts Council wants. We all know that we have to deal with policy and public life and social life, and that has to be contextualized in different ways at different times. But I think there was a really strong feeling from the people that we spoke to that the inherent value of the arts has to be prioritized. That's where the richness lies. That's the base from which all its social impact can happen. This seemed to be one of the really positive things that came out of the research, both from some of the data and from the work that Dimi did. The latest creative professional survey has a figure of 82% of you thought or think that Wales is a good place to live as a creative professional, and 72% of you think it's a good place to work. So you want to be here. Being here is important to you. There are a few quotes that I'm not going to read out, which will just come up over the next couple of slides. They are verbatim quotes that came through the qualitative research process, so there are bits of language that might not read very well first time, but it's how people spoke to us. So in that spirit of qualitative research, saying back what people say to you, we have done them in the quotes as they were recorded. One of the other things that seemed really important is that where you are seems very important to the work that you do. So the context of being in Wales feels like it's a really important thing for you. There was also something that came through, which was that notion of being here, but sometimes having to think about how you're somewhere else in order to be able to make a career, in order to be able to sustain a career. Some people questioned what that notion of career was anyway, and there were discussions about career or vocation or what's the work about. I think this particular person sort of just recognized that sometimes you build your working life here, but when you go elsewhere, whether that's into other parts of the UK or internationally, you sort of have to start again, and how do you make sense of that starting and establishing and starting again? And then there was a whole area which was about how do you sustain a working life here? How do you make your ends meet as a human being, as well as how do you make your life as a creative professional? And I think this quote we felt was a good capture of that notion of about having to do different things to make a livelihood here. The Creative Professionals survey, the results from that at the moment, on that first survey, it was a third of people were saying that they make their living just from their work within the creative, from being a creative professional. So two-thirds of the people who call themselves creative professionals are having to have a working life that means they earn money from other types of work. And there was, I think some of those things are really significant to think about how do we make sustainable lives for artists and creative professionals. So some of the things that came through as themes, I'm going to run through these next couple of slides quite quickly, but just a few things to think about. One was very much about the place and the creative individual, that sense of belonging, which I've mentioned already, really important, and the sense of inspiration that comes from being here. Wales as home was talked about by lots of people, very understandably. Wales as home was also talked about by people who perhaps didn't come from Wales originally, but had made their home here, and about what a rich experience that had been. I think at the time we did the research, there was something coming through within some of the focus groups about Wales being less competitive in terms of funding. I think that's probably shifting at the moment in terms of what might be happening with the scale of lottery funding available or the number of applications that are being received. I think there was a tipping point that happened the year before last where it got to a point where more applications were being not supported than were being supported. And so that the quants on that are shifting a bit as well. I think everyone was very conscious of that need to be entrepreneurial. Part of the research was about looking at networks and about how to make connections between different people and about how that might be addressed into the future. And one of the things that I think we felt very strongly within that was that geography matters. It's quite easy to network here in Cardiff. It's harder in other parts of Wales to sometimes be connected to your colleagues and fellow practitioners. I think that's one of the things that needs to be picked up into the future. And one of the big things just on the last one there was about exposure outside of Wales, partly within the UK and partly within an international context that got repeated a lot through a lot of what was said. So just going to talk very briefly about one area of the report which is sort of goes into the numbers and into the statistical portrait, as it's called. The statistical portrait took the Welsh data from a really big set of UK data called the Annual Population Survey. The Annual Population Survey takes responses from something like 300,000 individuals and feeds them into a big set of government data. Within Wales, obviously, that's a proportion of the big picture. The creative industries, cultural industries, arts industries become a slightly smaller part of that. So the data that Rhys was looking at was sort of a small subsection of a really big set of UK data. But it's a really interesting set of data, I think, when you begin to look at it. It classifies jobs and occupations against a really wide spectrum of what are called SOC codes, occupational codes. I'm going slightly nerdy now, so I'm going to stop. But SOC codes are the way that within the annual population survey, the work that you do gets classified, and from those classifications, we can draw out some data about working conditions here. One of the areas that I'm just going to give you a little bit of data about is about actors, artists, and musicians in Wales. And perhaps a reassuring thing for you is that your working lives here are very similar to working lives that other people experience in other parts of the UK. Your age profile, the amount you earn, the hours that you work, aren't broadly dissimilar to the UK averages, the UK medians. There's a spike about earnings and about age and some things that happens in an area called London and the South East. You might have had experience of that. In the report, for those that might venture that far into the quantitative data, we draw some differentiation between what happens in Wales, what happens in London and the South East, and what happens in the rest of the UK. So there are some differences between here and London and the South East, but there's a lot of similarity between Wales and the rest of the UK. So if you're an actor, artist, or musician in Wales, 2 out of 3 of you have a higher education qualification. That's quite high compared to other areas of occupational life. But 9 out of 10 of you are self-employed or are employees on temporary contracts. That's significantly higher than the general population. And 4 out of 10 of you work part-time, and almost 1 in 5 would like to work longer hours. So that notion of being skilled but in a precarious position, that slide before, seems to be very reflective of what the data's showing us. I think that's probably a sense of what many of you have from your lives as artists or producers or curators or people working in the arts. We made in the report 14 groups of recommendations to the Arts Council. Some are shorter, some are longer, but they're in the areas which are about investment, infrastructure and networks, and advocacy, and then a couple which were slightly more general. I'm not going to try going through all of them, but I'm just going to pull out a couple that I think perhaps give a flavour of where the report ended up, what it ended up saying most strongly. And one of the lead ones for us was about trying to recommend that there's greater parity of opportunity with other parts of the UK. Part of that, for individuals, is about the amount that you can apply to and the thresholds that you can apply to. Scotland and England have a small grant threshold of 15,000. Wales has a small grant threshold of 5,000. If you're an individual in England or Scotland, you could theoretically be applying up to 100,000. That doesn't necessarily mean that everyone is applying for 3 times the amount of money that they are applying for in comparison to Wales, or that they're being awarded 3 times the amount of money. But I think that notion of there being a more flexibility that enables the best projects to be invested in, and for that, I think, additional level of investment that would actually make some good projects become great projects, and just allow some of the work that individuals and creative professionals are doing here to flourish a little bit more. As I said earlier, enhanced investment in Creative Wales seems a really good thing to do to us. I appreciate there are funding pressures that make that a choice amongst other things, but I think the impact that Creative Wales has had has been really rich. One of the things that came up quite a lot, this is the last slide, was about workspace and about where you make your work, and that feels to be something that seems to be in circulation at the moment within different art form practices as well, that recognition that space is a really important part of what you can do. The notion about how to build on the relationship with FE and higher education was referenced quite a lot within the qualitative research, and we feel there's a role within that that some of the revenue-funded organisations could be addressing in particular. And the last one we've got here is about that whole area of increasing promotion outside of Wales and supporting practitioners to develop their careers, their livelihoods, and their reputations outside of Wales. That's it. Thanks.
Okay. Thanks very much, Chris. I wanted to just touch on a couple of things that you were alluding to in the report. And we do urge everybody to explore the report and think about it. And Council will be thinking about it again in March. But one of the things that comes out quite strongly, and it comes out in all sorts of aspects of Welsh life, is a strong dependency on public sector driven matters. So it's not part of the research, but do you have any feeling for how that situation is going to need to be addressed? Because if artists are fairly crucially linked into public sector circumstances, and public sector circumstances are changing very rapidly and under severe pressure, then that sense of a public sector supported artist base is going to come under increasing pressure. So the idea that what you were picking up about entrepreneurialism, being outside Wales as much as inside Wales, it just feels these are themes that are going to grow in importance. Would you share that view? Or
I'd share that view, for sure. I think what the quantitative data was showing was that there is a higher proportion of public sector employment in Wales for creative professionals than in other parts of the UK.
Yeah.
The data that goes into the annual, or the data that Rhys used is actually taking a 10-year period to give the sample size that gives it to be able to take a robust view out of some of the sample sizing. I'd be really surprised if that didn't change over the next period, over the period of time. So certainly, if that's a diminishing area of investment, then if we want to sustain livelihoods, then we have to do other things to address that. I think it's harder for individuals to have a personal response to that within Wales. I think the role or the impact on individuals is their engagement by the organisations that tend to be the ones that get the local authority investment. So I think the first challenge is perhaps more within an organisational context than an individual working life context. Mm-hmm. But there are certainly things like public art, which are very much, or have been very much invested in within a public sector environment. But yes, it's shifting. The economics are shifting. We see that in the work we do on a day-to-day. The economics are shifting.
Okay.
It's harder to get. I think one of the consequences, perhaps, is that it's harder to get some of the match funding to match some of your own funding.
Yeah.
That feels harder than it has perhaps been in the past, because there aren't the pools of local authority money as a potential source. But I think we are entrepreneurial. We are resourceful. It takes time to adjust to that. Things will be lost that we might have wanted to keep. But we'll find a way to respond to that, because that's how we are, I think.
And the second thing I wanted to just pick up with you was this whole notion of the creative profession.
Yeah.
Because, and I think, Dimi, you found this in the talking you did to artists, but perhaps a question for both of you. We definitely in Arts Council have begun talking more and more about creative professionals, partly because the creative world is made up of all sorts of people who are artists, but also creative producers, all sorts of roles that are now supporting, integrated with the work of the artist. That is a sort of expanding field. It's technologically expanding as well. And somehow, in certainly within the last 3 years, we've been talking, until the report came along, fairly comfortably about creative professionals. It's also been our view that that also links to recognition, rates of pay, read across with other professionals, if you like, that artists traditionally have not been able to just get the ease of that read across to professions, if you like. So talking about creative professionals has felt comfortable to the Arts Council, but the report gives us pause for thought, because people are talking about don't categorize us. Our essential thing is a vocation as an artist. The artist will do certain things that will drive out results or whatever. So some thoughts from both of you on this notion of creative professional artist. Mm. Is it a dichotomy? Should we be worried about it?
I have less, as someone who's, I have less concern myself, but I recognize that the concern that people had that was coming into the into our research felt very genuine. And I think that is as much about because of the concern about the arts being classified as a creative industry rather than as a cultural industry in a way. I think the notion of a creative professional, if it's well explained, isn't necessarily an issue. But I think one of the things that feels was coming through a lot of the discussions we had, and I think in some of the conversations we've had with you in terms of talking about the report, perception is a really hard thing sometimes. And when you think you're being clear, sometimes you aren't being as clear to other people as you feel you're being clear to yourselves in what you're trying to say. So I think there's a perception about the relationship between the arts and creative industry, and that and some of that push that feels like a genuine one that has, or a genuine debate that's been going on. It feels like it's within that in that realm. But I think there are things about perception within all of this that it's really important to address, and about how ideas about the how that ideas are communicated, and about how people are involved in that, perhaps.
So, Dimi, you came up against this in your oral history of the project.
Yes, to build on this, I think a part of that reaction was more like a caution of not thinking of art in any different way, like in terms of value, like preserving that value of art, which came across as a strong theme in our research, and because of the ongoing rhetoric about the creative industries and all the attention, kind of the shift in vocabulary, if you want, elsewhere and increasingly here, I think that causes. Concern would be too strong a word, but that causes some thought as to what are the arts, are we going to lose anything by shifting that vocabulary, right. And is it going to introduce new demands, new pressures, which are not an inherent part of what the understanding of arts and their role is?
Okay, so tell me some of the things that you found surprising when you sat down with a group of artists.
It's always fascinating to talk to artists. I've done.
Perhaps we should say a bit about your research before you sat down to the artists.
Yes, my research. Well, I've been talking to creative people for many years now. It started when I did 3 year research in West Yorkshire in film, television, and then it expanded, kind of talking to people about how they learn, how technology has changed their skills, what are the issues of actually working outside of London, when a lot of production seems to be happening in London, and issues around careers. So kind of broad working life, learning and careers issues. So I started with doing this, and then I continued. I did my next piece of research was in Scotland, so that was a very different picture to some extent, because I felt you know, there was no such hesitation about talking about creative industries as industries. But I was also, so it's being a part of my wider research interests and projects. So I did research in Scotland into comedy in particular, where I looked at working lives of stand-up comedians.
And, right.
And then when I joined Cardiff University, you know, it was there was this exciting project which I had recently joined, I think, and I heard about the call you've made, so we linked with field work, etc. So it's being a part of my wider personal project, if you want, personal research interest, kind of talking about what is it like to work in a creative setting.
No common denominators with stand-up comedians.
The thing about the creative, I have to say yes and no, but that probably won't give a substantive answer to your question. When we talk about creative settings, there are always commonalities, but also there are substantial differences between areas and subsectors because of the heritage, because of the skills, because of the way certain creative fields operate. Some are more, for example, if you talk about a TV production, it's more team-based. You do require collaboration between people in a different real-time sense, though collaboration elsewhere might be in a different, take a different, form.
So you sat down with artists.
So what I did for this
country,
project?
Yeah.
Oh yes, so I've been talking to people around the country, kind of from London, the north of England, and Scotland, and talking to artists in Wales was I felt very excited, as felt very excited about. And it was indeed, very interesting. What we did was, in this qualitative part of the project, we wanted to grasp, as with any qualitative element, qualitative is a term we use, and I'm not sure it sounds as nice as we think it does. But what we do is we talk to people, we allow them to actually explain things or say how things have worked for them, and tell us their views, not in a pre-described kind of box or script or what the person who designed the survey might think about, but it's more like a bottom-up approach. As methodology, it still has predefined areas or questions we would like to discuss, but there is enough flexibility to actually allow people suggest new issues or say which issues matter more or which issues are irrelevant,
and
despite
some,
the fact we think they
something
might be.
Something you found surprising when you got into it?
Surprising. I was impressed by the link with the place, with the strong, which came very, very earlier on in the narratives, link with the place, but also appreciation of geography, of where you are, and geography where you are in Wales, and being in Wales as well, something which we identified as a wider theme, which was being in Wales and having a different world across the border, in a way, kind of the dual careers almost, the sense of different networks, kind of different world, if you want. Yeah. So that's what I found particularly interesting, and kind of I think it's something worth building upon, kind of researching that further, really.
Yeah.
Because, of course, there is the creative element to it. There's also the very tangible working life element. If we think of a career as a way of making a living, in addition to kind of achieving fulfillment in your work. So
I think, I'll probably come back to this later with Ed Thomas and Ned Thomas about being in Wales and what you get from that, but what also you perhaps don't get or becomes part of the tension in how you work. But your conversation certainly picked that up, I think. I'm going to ask Caris just to say what other conversations have been going on, and also where we might be taking some of this material.
So dwi'n mynd i siarad Gymraeg os ydy hynny'n iawn. So yn sgil yr ymchwil a naeth Chris a Dimi a Rhys, mi wnaethon ni benderfynu bod yn bwysig i ni fynd allan yna i siarad â phobl Cymru ac i cael gwell teimlad o beth oedd pobl yn ei feddwl. So wnaethon ni gynnal tri sgwrs yn benodol wedi dewis peidio canol un yng Nghaerdydd, herd fel wedodd Chris, mae pobl yn teimlo bod na ddigon o gyfleoedd yng Nghaerdydd i rhwydweithio os ydyn nhw'n dewis gwneud hynny. Felly wnaethon ni gynnal sgwrs yn Abertawe, yn Aberystwyth ac yn Llandudno i siarad gydag artistiaid ac i just cael syniad o fel ni'n symud yr ymchwil yma ymlaen a fel oedd yn bwysig i ni gyfathrebu ag artistiaid o draws Cymru. Oedd yn ddiddorol iawn er bod na wahaniaethau daearyddol a ieithyddol yn digwydd ar draws y wlad, mi oedd y themau tebyg iawn yn codi ym mhob un sgwrs ag eitho ni a tri peth a daeth i'r brig mewn ffordd. Yr un oedd bydd cwrdd yn rhanbarthol, wyneb yn wyneb, bod na angen i bobl gweld ei gilydd mewn ffordd a siarad wyneb yn wyneb heb just bod ar y we neu dros rhyw fath o fforwm ar y cyfrifiadur felly. A bod dim wastad rhaid i hynny fod yn cael ei arwain gan cyngor celfyddydau. Weithiau chi'n teimlo bod angen i ni wneud popeth, oedd y neges cryf yn dod nôl. Os yw pobl angen rhwydweithio, weithiau mae angen i bobl gwneud hynny hunain. Ond bod yna bwysigrwydd i ni ceisio rhoi cyfleoedd ffurfiol ar draws y flwyddyn i bobl dod at ei gilydd. So dyn ni'n mynd i edrych ymlaen a gwneud mwy o hynny wrth i'r flwyddyn mynd yn ei flaen. Y peth arall daeth i'r bri oedd ble mae'r cefnogaeth i artistiaid canol gyrfa, bod na angen cyfleoedd i gael mentora neu siarad am sgiliau a sut i ddatblygu sgiliau a collaborations gwahanol gyda ffurfiau gwahanol. Felly, ni'n gorfod edrych ar sut ni'n symud hynny ymlaen os yna ffordd ymarferol y gallen ni weithio gyda chi yn y sector i ddatblygu cyfleoedd mentora, rhannu sgiliau ac yn y blaen, ac a'i'r fforymau sgwrs yw'r lle gorau wneud hynny neu os yna rhywbeth arall dylen ni fod yn gwneud a gweithio gyda'r sefydliadau ni fyd oherwydd mae yna lot o bethau da yn digwydd gyda'r rhai sefydliadau o gwmpas Cymru yn barod. A wedyn y peth olaf yw er bod pobl yn lico cwrdd wyneb yn wyneb, bod angen cyfleoedd rhywbeth ar y we felly, bod na pobl yn gallu, os maen nhw'n methu dod wyneb yn wyneb am beth bynnag rheswm o ran trafnidiaeth neu amser neu edrych o'r plant neu beth bynnag yw e, bod na gyfle i pobl ddalan gyda'r trafodaeth ac i cymryd rhan yn hynny wrth i ni fynd ymlaen. So mae angen i ni edrych ar, yr alumnau nawr ac i sefydlu rhyw fath o rhwydwaith ariama i'r alumnau. Ond sut ydyn ni'n edrych yn fwy eang na hynny er mwyn galluogi pobl i gysylltu â'i gilydd. Er mwyn bod ni'n gallu parhau ar sgyrsiau yma sy'n mor ddiddorol y pan ni'n cyrdd.
Yeah. So, clearly some things that can build on the research and get more into our practice as an arts council, but some things too that we're looking for a bit of self-starting from the artist sector.
Yn bendant. Chymru, mae lle gyda ni, fel dod oedd Chris, mae'n lle, dyn ni'n barod yn edrych ar un proses i ariannu ni, a sut ydyn ni'n edrych ar hynny, a sut ydyn ni'n gallu bod yn fwy hygyrch i bawb yn y sector. Ond mae artistiaid yn dweud hefyd dweud wrthyn ni, os da chi'n neud popeth i ni, wel, mae angen yr egni yna yn dod gyda ni hefyd, neu fyddwn ni jyst yn eistedd nôl ac yn tynnu popeth oedd wrthych chi, a ddim yn mynd allan yna, a bod yn entrepreneurial. Felly mae angen i ni, chymod, mae yna bartneriaeth cryf angen bod, fel bod ni'n helpu cefnogi pethau, ond hefyd bod ni'n galluogi'r sector i wneud hynny hefyd, a falle bod hynny jyst yn rhoi lle i rywun gwrdd neu dechrau trafodaeth, ond nid bod yna drwy'r amser.
I'm going to ask Ian, just as a, from the point of view of a Creative Wales award holder in the past, but also as a mid-career professional identified as maybe we should be doing more for mid-career, just for some reactions that you had when you sort of read through the report, or is it a familiar situation that you find there? Is it a changed situation from maybe 10 years ago, or how do you sense it?
I think the concerns in the report have been concerns for a long time, and what's made clear in the report is that they are still there and that there's need to act upon them. It's interesting, when I sat on a panel like this in Theatre Clwyd about 3 years ago, I remember Mr. Capaldi saying to me, when I said I'd lost faith in Wales and I needed to get out, he said maybe it was a midlife crisis. I thought a lot about that. It wasn't a midlife crisis, it was a mid-career crisis, which is slightly different. And it came about because as artists, we do respond to our environments. And I realized I was a pre-devolution writer in certain ways. And I responded in spite of. And post-devolution, I had good faith with this country because I felt that we should have faith with this country. And I came to a point where I lost faith, not in myself as a middle-aged person, but actually in my ability to respond, because I wanted to have good faith with this country, but I needed to get out. Yeah. And that was the fantastic thing about the Creative Wales, and I will, for those that are going to get it today, and I to congratulate you in advance, it is a stunning license to be creative, to imagine. And I cannot thank those that awarded me that money, because I've been to many countries, and it's enabled me to rethink. And also to reposition myself as a mid-career artist and be inspired again. And that's what I think the Creative Wales in particular can do, is inspire. With regard to structures, the trouble is in theatre, for instance, when you get to certain points, some people have been at certain points for a very long time, and they need to move on. For their own sake, they desperately want to move on. But where do they move on to? And you know, we have an industry that gets to a certain level, but we need bigger ladders.
You said something that's very striking to me on another occasion where you were talking just about Wales and the cultural project being sort of retrospective, whereas actually within devolved Wales, it's got to be a future project. I found that really stimulating way of thinking about things, that maybe there is a sort of way in which you relate to the past constantly in Wales, but if devolution isn't a future project, and you feel quite buoyant about that now.
I do. I mean, we will hear from Ed later, who's a great guy. He goes on about, he basically reiterates a lot of Gwyn Alf's thoughts upon reinvention and recreation of myth. And it struck me, you know, Gwyn Alf wrote the book, obviously, When Was Wales? And then David Adams, when he wrote the book in 97 about the state of Welsh theatre at the time, his question was, where was Wales? And then a book's recently been published by Simon Brooks, a stunning book, though from a right-wing perspective. It's well worth reading. It's called Pam Na Fi Cymru. Why did Wales not come into existence? Yeah. And I found this kind of fascinating, you know, because this recreation of myth is something that should have, in certain ways, come to an end with the creation of the Assembly. Because, I mean, if we think historically about this nation, in feudal times there was no such thing as nation, as a political entity or a geographic entity. We only came into being, as Gwyn Alf says, in the time of the Commonwealth. When, for expediency and because we were some sort of religious project, then Wales was hived off. That's Gwyn Alf's thesis. So for the last 400 years, we have been a nation that's not really been allowed to imagine ourselves, to quote Anderson. We've only been allowed to imagine ourselves in relation to those that have given us that license. Now, and that's the recreation of the myth. You know, it's a myth, it's a dream, but it's a dream that comes from a position where we don't ever think it will become reality, which kind of Zizek goes on about. So I'm thinking to myself, with the devolution happening in 97, we must stop recreating a myth. Because recreating a myth is a fantasy. Is Wales, you know, when was this fantasy? Where is this fantasy? Why is this fantasy still happening and not allowing the reality to be born? And that was my problem post-assembly, was I wanted this reality to be born because I didn't want to create myths anymore. I wanted future.
So just bring that back to the situation of the artist and the, I mean, obviously your personal take on that. It does feel that this research currently, this snapshot of where artists are at, you have this sort of feeling that people want to be in Wales. They're comfortable in Wales. When the Crafts Council did some research about craftspeople in Wales, there were far more returners than starters. And albeit that we might want to try and address something for the mid-career artists, it feels like our investment needs to be all the time in creative starters, because the future project has to be the one that we're all concerned with creating.
It is, and it's not for my generation to do that. And that's why those that are young and can imagine our nation here in this room, you are the future that will create this Wales that is devoid of a past myth. It'll be reality for you. And I trust and I hope and I'm sure that you will dream, you will imagine this nation for us. Mm-hmm. And as you then become mid-age artists, then your terms of reference will be different to mine. Because I am stuck in the past. I am stuck around 96, to be honest with you. Because politically, that's when I felt I could react against. And you know what reinvigorated me, Mr. Capaldi, was actually the Scottish, the way the London press turned against Scotland. And I'm an in spite of artist, always have been. I was born of that period. And I suddenly realized what the beast was again. Because the beast reared up, and the beast had been quiet for maybe 15, 20 years post-devolution. But the beast reared itself up again, and I realized that was the energy I needed to react against. And so, Mr. Capaldi, I found the energy again when Scotland actually gained independence. And then recently again, I wrote a drama series for Radio Cymru, and I couldn't really work out the narrative. And then, post-Brexit, I suddenly was inspired again. Whether I'm for or against Brexit or anybody in this room, it's irrelevant. But the fact is it polarized us. It's given us something to react against. It's been a negative positive for me. You know? But as a mid-scale artist, what is great is to still be able to have the license to react, you know, to your habitus, yeah, to your environment, to be creative and to be alive. And I hope the Arts Council continues for many years to give those opportunities for mid-career artists in particular to be alive.
Okay. Well, we put quite a lot out there now through the research, through giving you a feel for it. This is the bit where it's over to you for the next half hour or so. On your tables, there are some questions and some sheets of paper, and they're intended to be start topics for a conversation around the table. They're a real mixed bag of questions. Some of them relate very strongly to the research. Some of them are a bit more left field. But we hope in the next half hour you can marshal some of your thoughts around the questions on the table. We want you to scribble any thoughts that you have around the questions, but also if there's something that you've heard this afternoon about that you'd like to follow up on, make a note of that on the table too. So over to you.